إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونتوب إليه ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين فصلوات الله وسلامه على خير من أرسل سيدنا ونبينا ورسولنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تأسى به واتبع سنته إلى يوم الدين اللهم اجعلنا منهم اللهم آمين إن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن خير الأمور عزائمها وشر الأمور محدثاتها كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم يوم ترونها تذهل كل مرضعة عما أرضعت وتضع كل ذات حمل حملها وترى الناس سكارى وما هم بسكارى ولكن عذاب الله شديد. My dear brothers, sisters, there is a certain sunnah, a system, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this world and that it has to be subjugated to, is that there is always a struggle between ideas, various ideas. Sometimes a struggle translates from even intellectual to physical. But there is always that struggle, ideas that are not in agreement with each other. They are bound to clash. And Islam is no different. As a matter of fact, all prophets had the same issue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ عَدُوًّا مِّنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ وَكَفَى بِرَبِّكَ هَادِيًا وَنَصِيرًا. And that we made to for every prophet, لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ, every prophet, Adu had an enemy of the mujrimeen, of the criminals. So this is the sunnah, that there is always a struggle. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ لَفَسَدَتِ الْأَرْضِ. So if it weren't for the people, the good people preventing the bad people from spreading corruption, the earth will be corrupted. That's the system. If there is no haqq, there will be batil. If there is no truth, there is falsehood. If there is no morality, there will be immorality. Something has to exist because there will be no vacuum. Cannot be a vacuum. No people have to live according to something. They have to have a standard to live according to. There will be no vacuum. And Islam now is definitely the most fought against and the most resisted because it is Islam. You know, normally the struggle, and the one who takes a limelight in the struggle is the one who has the biggest impact, the biggest threat, the biggest conflict, or the biggest resistance to the dominant ideas. If Islam was some trivial religion, something that is minor, that can be neglected, and there are many religions without mentioning names, you don't even hear about them in the media. You don't even see or you don't hear about conferences and meetings and billions of dollars and experts and analysts and all of that that are mobilized to discredit that belief. But because Islam is great, the effort to stop it is also great. Because Islam is the only thing that stands between humanity and where it is heading. And therefore it has to be stopped, and the effort for that, it is great. And we, the Muslim Ummah, have many challenges. And many of them are very apparent and very visible and things that we see every day. When you look at the social media, when you read the news, you see them. We are living them. We are talking about occupied lands of Muslims, where the people, the Muslims of these lands, are killed, are humiliated, are subjugated to torture. And here, examples of Palestine, examples of Kashmir, the Rohingya Muslims, the Muslims in China, These are just the hot flashes, the hot spots. And if we don't hear about them, it's not because the problem is solved or gone away, or now everything is okay. It's just that it is not the hot spot now, because there's something else that is dominating the scene. The wealth of the Muslims and the Muslim Ummah is the wealthiest of nations. And they have the most natural resources worldwide. And you find some of the poorest countries in the Muslim world, in the world, are actually Muslims. You find the waters are taken by occupiers, they're taken by different countries, while the Muslims are actually dying of thirst in certain regions. You have the oil that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed the Muslim Ummah with, that's owned. And you find that actually still it is sent most of the time crude, and it is returned as it's brought from overseas or from the different countries at a higher price. All of that, you know, the money that is generated by the revenues that the Muslim Ummah has is going overseas and mainly goes to the West, and they thrive and they live, while the Muslims are actually, some of us are dying from hunger. Technology. We, the Muslim Ummah, are the third world countries in technology. And because while we have the expertise and we have the people, we have the brains, we have the natural resources, yet you find the Muslims are still lagging behind the whole world. And of course, what cannot be missed is the political situation in the Muslim Ummah. You have tyrants, you have a more mafia-like gangs ruling the Muslim world, and that's worldwide, and I do not make an exception. Where they are, they torture, they maim, they punish, they kill, they execute in the tens of thousands, and nobody, with impunity. Nobody can actually say anything for them. Not only that, but now they're actually spearheading the corruption of Muslim Ummah, the Muslim minds, whether it's through the Abrahamic faiths that they are establishing, or wal'iyadu billah al-fahisha that they are actually instituting and putting in the lands of the Muslims, even in the lands of Kaaba, they are putting that there as well. That has not stopped them. But when we look at these challenges and we look at these problems, we have to put them in perspective. In other words, they are not really, in my humble view, they are not the biggest challenges that are facing the Muslim Ummah. Because the Muslim Ummah, these are as big as they are. The Muslim Ummah is based on an idea. The idea, the belief, the conviction that La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. It is what gathers us. It is what sets our way of life. It's what sets our view of life. It's what sets our relationship with each other and other nations. That belief system, that idea, that if it is threatened, then you're talking about existential threat to the Muslim Ummah. So really the challenges to the Muslim Ummah now, the biggest challenges are intellectual, not military, because those, most of them are related to the political situation in the Muslim Ummah. But the reality that now the biggest threat to the Muslims is the intellectual ideas, or the ideas that are propagated amongst the Muslims, and unfortunately some of us are embarking them or accepting them. So let's take some just few ideas and see the devastation that they have done in the West and what they are doing in the Muslim world as well. Take secularism as an example. And secularism in the West, and most people, by the way, when they think of secularism, it's like they taught us in school, that secularism is separation of church and state, separation of religion from life. As if the equation stops here, or the definition stops here. In reality, that's just where it begins. I just mentioned that there is no vacuum. So if the religion is not going to be governing life, meaning morality in life is not going to be governed by religion, it's not going to be governed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if the right and wrong is not going to be determined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then who's going to do it? What is the reference point? And that makes the reference point the people. And the people decide what is good and what is bad. And therefore, you have the fahisha spread amongst the people. You have the idea that even what is an acceptable, source of information has, or for knowledge, has been actually tailored that nothing can come from any holy book, from any book, for not the Quran, not the Sunnah, or anything like that. We have the people who are actually in the Muslim world, even when they call for revival of the Muslims, when they call for progress, they call for it under the guise of secularism. Under secularism, there is no moral standard. Under secularism, there is nothing called, this is the way that what is righteousness and what is falsehood or what is corrupt. All of that becomes subject to the whims of the people. Today, something is illegal and we deem it to be immoral. Tomorrow, because of whatever circumstances, we decide to reverse that. And that's what set the ground, what opened the Pandora's box, as they say, for all the things that we are experiencing now, and some of them are, I will give an example for inshallah. Take the idea of feminism. Just like secularism destroys, separates anything that's meaningful of religion to life, and for us Muslims, it means that actually you're destroying the deen. Because for us, the deen is not a private affair, but rather it is a way of life for the individual as well as the society. But take, that corrupts the religion, but look at what corrupts the family. When we talk about feminism, feminism is not just a matter of asking for their rights. It is for women to say that nothing that can dictate what is right and wrong from any holy book, from Islam or from the religion. It is the matter of equality, as they say, between the men and women. But not just in terms of rights and duties, but actually that the men and the women have the absolute equality in any relationship that they want. But this actually combined with the view that any religion or anything that is done, especially when we talk about Islam, anything with Islam actually that's derived in terms of the rights of the woman, the duties of the woman, etc. It is all derived from by men, by patriarchal structure that actually derived to serve the interests of these people. So in other words, when Imam al-Shafi'i or Ahmad bin Hanbal or Abu Hanifa or Imam Malik radiyallahu anhu ajma'in or al-Awza'i or rules, and the rules were taken from the era of the Sahaba. So they give with that all the Sahaba, when we talk Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali and all of these people were actually came up with rules to serve their interests at the expense of women. And the idea here is that we need to re-examine the entire culture of 1400 years remove the patriarchal aspect of it, and women have to actually do the tafsir. Women have to do the fiqh. Women have to do this and that. As if, just for argument's sake, if it is done by a woman, automatically she's going to be fair to the man. If the man was, when they did this deriving of rules, it was unfair to the woman, what would stop the woman from being unfair to the man when they drive the rules? But in reality, anybody who says this has no idea of how actually the books of fiqh are, how the idea of knowledge, the Islamic knowledge, how it's transferred, how it's examined, how that in reality many of the scholars were women themselves, and many of the scholars, famous scholars that we know, they had women who were their teachers as well. But all of this, the idea of equality, takes away the role of the family and the way Islam envisions that the relationship between men and women is complementary, that they both are a team in the family to make the family, to make it function in a certain way, in a way that's pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are not at a conflict, as in the Western idea of feminism. There is no conflict between men and women. There is no friction. There is no either you win or I win. That competition does not exist in our religion. It does not exist in our Islamic culture. So we're talking about the destruction of the family when we have such ideas, and such ideas have seeped into the mindset of Muslims as well. And you have the feminist movement. Some of them are actually practicing Muslims. They will tell you, I'm a Muslim feminist. And I don't really know what that means. Because if you are a Muslim, you have a reference point. It's called the Quran and the Sunnah. If you are thinking from different criteria, then you have a different criteria. For us in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nisa, وَلَا تَتَمَنَّوا مَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بِهِ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ لِلرِّجَالِ نَصِيبُ بِمَّا اكْتَسَبُوا وَلِلنِّسَاءِ نَصِيبُ بِمَّا اكْتَسَبْنَ وَاسْأَلُوا اللَّهَ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمًا. And do not wish what Allah ta'ala has bestowed for some over others. And, for the men have share of what they've earned, and the women have their share of what they've earned. and ask Allah Ta'ala from His pleasure, or ask us Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala from His bounties. Indeed, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is most knowledgeable of everything. We have a different point of view in life, a different way that we view the relationship. A relationship that makes a, generates a healthy family, a healthy environment, a healthy ummah. But when we talk about men and women at each other's throats, you know that it is either yours or mine. This is not the, this is not our fight, not our point of view in life altogether. And keep in mind something that really must be mentioned, that all the culture that we experience now was all as a resulted as a reaction to the way European experience with religion, with Christianity specifically, with Catholicism specifically. You know, we're talking about an experience that existed with that by or experienced by some people, and now they are, due to that bad experience, they want to, you know, dominate the entire world with the results of that experience, what they have reached. Another idea that can be very detrimental to the Muslim Ummah is to have subjective understanding of the text. And now you have people, when you tell them, you know, Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu said such and such, he will tell you, well, if Abu Hanifa can say it, I can say it too. You know, why can't I have my own understanding? As if Abu Hanifa, we followed Abu Hanifa, or we took his opinion because he was Abu Hanifa. Abu Hanifa and Shafi'i and Malik and all of these scholars of Islam throughout history, they had certain requirements, men and women of them. They had certain standards of knowledge that they have achieved, without which you are not going to be able to understand the Islamic text. It has nothing to do with being an Arab or non-Arab. It has nothing to do with being male or female. It has nothing to do with your capabilities, but rather it has to do with the standards of knowledge that you need to understand a text. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ, that we sent it down as an Arabic Quran so you may comprehend it. Anybody, by definition, if you don't know Arabic well enough to understand this text, you are not going to be qualified to do it. If you are going to approach the Sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you do not know the Hadith Sahih and the Hadith Da'if and the science of Hadith, how it functions and why, then how are you going to approach it? And if you don't know Usul al-Fiqh, the principles of jurisprudence, how to look at the text, how to look at the Quran and the Sunnah together, so that you can derive rules properly. If you don't know it, you are not going to be able to derive it. The idea, what we will experience, is exactly what Christians went to when the Protestants came and they said that, well, actually, you can have your own individual understanding. So you sit with two Christians, and each one will give you about God, not a rule here and there, their view of God, and each one will have a separate view. This is a destruction of the Muslim Ummah and the deen itself. Because when the deen becomes subjective, each person does understand this the way they want. There is no structure. There is no approach for any science. Do I dare, because even if I read a medical book, do I dare to start, you know, doing what doctors do and prescribing medicine and deciding, you know, this is the problem with you, this is not the problem with you. But we find that easier to do with the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if it's, you know, open field for everybody. It is open field for people to go learn, gain knowledge, understand it, then speak, and then you will have the scholars listening to you as well, because you will be one of them. But if you do not have that, and we are spending our days, it's okay, we're not, you know, by definition, we're not going to be able to do the same thing, all of us. If I'm spending most of my day at work and earning for my family, etc., I don't have the time to do that, you know, to that kind of studying, to become on that level of understanding. It's okay. And that's a ibadah, inshallah ta'ala. But still, I will know my size. I will know what I'm able to do, what I'm not able to do, etc. To reduce Islam to simply my opinion and yours, you know, and mine is just as valid as Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's, then, you know, that person, whoever says that, has no clue what the Islamic sciences are all about. Another idea that has become much more, you know, stronger especially in the last two decades, with homosexuality. And homosexuality, we many people, of many of us, still think that it's a matter of, you know, it's haram, you know, it's a haram act, so just don't do it. And I tell my children, it is haram, don't do it. Homosexuality is much bigger than simply a fahisha that's being done or a bad act that's being done. Homosexuality is a result of a worldview. It's a result of what is called the fluid human being. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the idea of what a human being male or female, that itself now is being challenged. They said, who says that? For us Muslims, we say Allah Ta'ala says that. Biology said that. You know, that you have a male and a female. You know, but they tell you, well, that physical has nothing to do with how I feel. And therefore, the human is what you define yourself to be. You are whatever you want to be. That's a philosophical point of view, not a matter of doing fahisha. A philosophical point of view because it sees that human being is what I decided to be. And now when they approach Muslims, and some Muslims, some of our children tell you, I don't see what the problem is. I'm sympathetic with them. I am, without understanding that it's not just a matter of a choice, it's a matter of view that actually goes against the heart of Islam for what is an insan. You know, they are talking about the fluid human being or the post human being, something that they are generating based on the idea that even morality, whether this is a moral act or immoral act, morality was replaced with consent. If both of them are saying okay, then there is no problem. But for us Muslims, there is morality. It does not go away. For us Muslims, there is a male and female. For us Muslims, even if there is consent, if there is no marriage, that is a zina, that's a crime in the eyes of God and the eyes of the Muslim Ummah. We need to be able to address these ideas because these ideas are actually now, they are penetrating the Muslim Ummah and they are causing really what I call an existential threat for Islam and the Muslim Ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our Ummah and protect our deen. Jazakumullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين Brothers and sisters, it has to be clear that if we're talking about, you know, addressing the Ummah at large, and that's how we should be thinking, that we are members of this Ummah and we need to think of how to solve problems for the Ummah at large. We cannot isolate that from the political situation that the Muslim Ummah is living. Without changing the political situation of the Muslim Ummah, we are left as individuals and as communities here and there fending for ourselves. Because at the end of the day, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّمَا الْإِمَامُ جُنَّةِ يُقَاتَلُ مِنْ وَرَائِهِ وَيُتَّقَى بِهِ The Imam, the head of the state, the leader of the Muslims, the Sultan of the Muslims, is a protection for the Muslims. That's the job. The job is to implement Islam, protect the Muslim Ummah, not just physically. Protect them from these kinds of ideas through education and through, you know, having the refutation of the ideas that are contradictory to Islam, you know, in motion. So that has to be said, and does not mean, therefore, that in the process, until Allah Ta'ala changes the situation of the Muslim Ummah, that we sit tight and we do nothing. At the end of the day, each of us is responsible for their own children, and each of us are responsible for each other, because إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةِ We are supposed to help each other towards righteousness. وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ الْعُدْوَانِ You know, that help each other towards righteousness and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We as a community, we need just like the Quran al-Kareem, address these ideas of kufr, whether the ideas of Trinity or the ideas of what the Jews said about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or about the people who were idol worshippers, etc. We need to teach ourselves and our children the ideas about how to refute such ideas on an intellectual level. Just we need to present them in depth and we need to answer them in depth. And our children have to be exposed to them because they are living them. They are experiencing them in school. They're experiencing them in the media. They're experiencing them in, you know, in social media with the interaction of each other. Everybody is, you know, is hearing the ideas that are hovering around this. You know, why should Islam be this, not that? You know, what's wrong with homosexuality? What's wrong with, you know, I should be able to understand the, you know, Islam by myself because I feel this or I feel that. You know, ideas like that, we need to really take charge of them and to start presenting a different narrative, a narrative that sets right from truth based on the aqidah of Islam. We need to have our teachers, whether they teach in full-time schools or teachers who teach in the Sunday school, they need to be educated about this. It is not about salah, it is not about siyam, it's not about, you know, how to pray, because that can be done in half hour to teach somebody. But we need to teach our children how to think, because as long as we, the Muslim Ummah, think based on the Aqidah of Islam, based on the doctrine of Islam, then this Ummah will be able to resist and will be able to move forward, will be able to even provide a solution, a better solution for mankind than what they are embarking on or what they are heading towards. But if we lose that way of thinking, and if we lose our identity in the process, and we start thinking based on a different worldview, a different point perspective in life, then it's just a matter of time. So we need to educate that with our, you know, educate our children with that. We need to show them that, to show them what it means to say, I believe in Islam. When you say, I believe in Islam, it means anything that's other than Islam is null and void. Anything that is not, you know, consistent with the Islamic aqidah is rejected. We need to set these standards, intellectual standards, convictions for the children so that they can understand how to deal with these ideas. We need to teach them that the haqq, the truth, is not subjective. The haqq and the truth is only one. Inna ad-deen 'inda Allah al-Islam. The deen that's accepted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Islam, nothing else but that. We need to teach them that. We need to teach them that our criteria in life, and that's what defines the Muslim Ummah as well. We need to teach them that our criteria in life, the halal and haram, we only do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made halal, and we refrain from anything that is haram, regardless how we feel about it. At that moment, feelings come and go. But we need to teach them that. And this is, by the way, it is not to, you know, show or to say that the Muslim Ummah is in trouble or not at all. But we need to put the challenges ahead of us, understand what we are up against, and rest assured that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make this deen supreme. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ يَعْلُو وَلَا يُعْلَى عَلَيْهِ. Islam has the upper hand, and it will not have anything that has the upper hand over it. Because that's the nature of Islam. Intellectually, it's superior. Intellectually, it is superior. The aqidah of Islam is absolute. You know, the book of Islam is protected. The sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is protected. Our deen is protected. Even the ahkam shar'iyyah are protected. You know, we have something that the humanity should, you know, we should give to humanity because they are lacking. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and guide our children. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and protect our deen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect the Muslim Ummah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us resume our way of life to guide humanity to that which is good for them. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unify the Muslim Ummah. And make us from those who hear something good and follow the best of it. اللهم عزنا بالإسلام وعز الإسلام بنا اللهم اجعلنا مما يسمعون القول فاتبعونا أحسنا اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا اللهم لا تسلط علينا من لا يخافك ولا يرحمنا وصل اللهم وسلم على محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وأقم الصلاة